Thank you, Angela. Let's see how we start this first. There we are. Okay, well, thank you. I hope you are not very tired, because the good thing when you speak last is that you don't have a time limit. So some housekeeping information as well. Don't worry about the dinner, because it will be coming here, not only. But, Olaf is paying, actually. So this is the housekeeping. Now, Olaf asked me, some of you in this room have seen previous versions of this compilation, which is a dynamic and not a static compilation. And when Olaf asked me about describe the subject that we would like to see a little bit, what not only what happens with BRI initiative, but what could be the impact of proposed projects or new projects on new maritime trade flows. I have also updated the stuff as much as I could with developments in various countries, for instance, Malaysia, Thailand, Nicaragua, South Europe, Panama, and so on. So I will try, if you agree, to move as quickly as possible through the introduction of what is the idea of the Belt and Road Initiative, or the One Belt, One Road project of President Xi, as it was known before. It changed its name, and it changed its name is interesting in case you don't know this, because a lot of people complained. First of all, India complained, and they said, well, there's no one road, one belt and one road. There are many belts and many roads. So after this, China changed it, and also they make it initiative in the sense that, you know, this is an idea. So if you have the money and the interest, you can jump on the idea and put money whereby we can develop infrastructure. And India actually did this, because India said, well, we have the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, so why don't we put our eggs there, and then you finance and we finance, etc. And we try to do it in a sort of this way. Anyway, the idea of BRI, what is it? That China has money it has to spend. That's the idea. So if you try to define and explain to people what is Belt and Road Initiative, it's extremely difficult, because there's no concepts that can define this initiative. China is talking to everybody, and everybody is interested to talk to China. So, and then, as I will show you later on a map, it seems that China is buying everything that is on sale. Not only developing infrastructure, but also buying historic buildings, theaters, football teams, half of Venice. No, President?
No.
Well, it's good that we changed watch then. So it is difficult to define the concepts. We would like to see this concept as, first of all, the Chinese, they see this concept as one of connectivity. They say their idea is that we connect the world. We connect the world through transport and infrastructure, and a world that is connected and interlinked is much safer and is much happier and is more communicative, etc. And there is a step towards global peace. This is the vision of President Xi and the way that he's presenting his project. Okay, so he has a lot of money to spend. 1 trillion he earmarked, and he found another trillion from other sources actually. But he has to spend his money. How is the question? Chinese are very smart. They have seen what happens with other people in the past that they had money. For instance, they saw what happened to the Arabs in the 70s with the famous petrodollars and the way that they lost all their money through high inflation. Then they saw what happens if you invest in infrastructure. And they took the example of Dubai. And Dubai, as you will remember, went bankrupt and it was salvaged by Abu Dhabi with $100 billion. So they see that, you know, if I put money into infrastructure, and they should, and they could put money because their country is underdeveloped in the north and northwest, it will take ages until it yields fruits. And in the meantime, you have to pay the bank, even if it is their own bank. And we shouldn't forget that 25% of Chinese GDP is non-performing loans. So China is in a way sitting on a boiling kettle in these regards. You know, they built whole cities, tremendous cities they built, and they remain the ghost cities without anybody moving in. So non-performing loans are quite a problem. So they said, well, if infrastructure takes so long to pay fruit, then we put my money into other people's infrastructure that pays immediately. So they started investing in Africa. There are 200 projects, major projects, industrial and infrastructure projects throughout Africa. Europe is their interest, and they're quite keen in investing in Europe, in infrastructure, ports in particular. So that is the idea. In Europe and the United States, we are not very happy with so much massive investment in infrastructure, that much of it we call it strategic. The Americans, they have created a rather secretive Senate committee whereby they are screening all proposed strategic infrastructure investments, or strategic investments, because the Americans call everything strategic. If you look at the things that they reserve for their own ships and they send them around the world, everything is strategic. We have done something similar also in Europe, starting the European Commission started a screening mechanism in 2017. We just voted for it last month. Is a mechanism. I call it a lukewarm mechanism because it has a consultative function to member states. In other words, I will tell you what I think about, but then it's up to you to decide in sovereignty and you know what you want to do with your with foreign investment. So it doesn't have much teeth in terms of. So we have done something like this also in Europe. One point that I make usually quite strongly is the interest that China is taking into the Mediterranean basin. I will say more a little bit further down. Mediterranean basin, which I have in the past called the hub of hubs or a super hub, is very focal, like the fulcrum of a pendulum for China and others, which connects three continents. In other words, Africa, North and West, Europe, and East Coast of North America. We have seen China is investing not only then in the areas I've mentioned, but also in South America, in Australia, and only recently President Xi last year mentioned that the South Latin America is next on the map of the BRI project. So there is an interest to go there as well. And here in this map, you can see the traditional road. And surprisingly, you can even see Montenegro now. So you see, this is a map from The Economist. So it seems that you are, if you are willing to pay, then you can put your port or your country on a map, even if the map is produced by The Economist, because I do not understand on a map like this to see Montenegro in the same size as I see, for instance, Malaysia or Indonesia or other countries. But anyway, so you see the Arctic, the North Sea, the North Sea routes, and they have a great interest in this, not because they see it so much as an alternative, but they go into joint venture with Russia, and from there Russia has big plans to export their oil and gas, particularly gas. They are currently building three liquefaction terminals on the Arctic Sea in partnership with China. So this is where the Chinese interest in the North Sea routes is to be found, rather than in navigation, because in navigation they have tried before. COSCO has tried before with five ships to start and offer a service. Very, very poor results. Maersk is trying now, again with poor results, but we will hear all about it tomorrow from Martin, so I will not say more about short sea route, North Sea route, excuse me. Here is then another very artistic representation of the plan, and next to it I show you how it was the Silk Road 400 years ago. Just to see the comparison is quite similar. You can see this in the handout. We pass from here because we have mentioned already what are the BRI objectives. I have mentioned already the way that China is presenting the project, and is presenting this project as a project with noble intentions of connecting the world. Now I have a little difficulty in seeing the fine print that is there, so I will look here to Martin's computer. So, as I said, as we speak, there's something like 200 Chinese projects in Africa, construction and operations. We've mentioned that investments in other parts of the world taking place. We've mentioned the possibility of a what we call a hub-free ship carrier project, which is something that we are currently researching. In other words, you have big ships that they carry ships. In other words, they become hub port independent. They stay, they stop in the middle of the Mediterranean, they unload four or five ships, which they go to four or five different ports, so there is no need for sea distribution around a big hub port. This is something that we are looking at. We have Russia that they're not quite happy, and they are developing their own BRI, and their own BRI is an axis that runs from the Persian Gulf all the way up to Moscow. They have signed an agreement with Iran, Azerbaijan and Russia, whereby they have created this corridor all the way to Moscow with a branch towards the west. In other words, towards the Black Sea and Turkey. China last year mentioned that these are the ports, these are the 15 ports that we would like to include on our part of the BRI. So we're doing some research ourselves to categorize those ports. Which could be those that they are hub, which are those that they are regional, and which ones are those with a more inferior, smaller function. Here you see parts of this. This is produced actually by Bloomberg, who calculated that in the past 10 years in Europe alone, China has invested more than 300 billion euros, which is a very impressive amount. On the left, you will see a few things about the divide again between North and South. In a sense, the South countries like Cyprus, Greece, recently Italy, and others, they are quite keen to talk to China when it comes to investments. Northern European countries, they do not like this, and they would like to see a more coordinated approach in how we receive Chinese money in infrastructure in Europe. First, the one who is holding the flag is Germany, but I must mention that Germany has received from China, with the exception of the UK, you see what happens on the map on the UK, most of them are football teams, but anyway, with the exception of the UK, Germany has received 10 times from China as much as they have received everybody else. So it is only reasonable to argue that once you have a strong position and then you have an advantageous position, you wouldn't want to share this with others. So well, this is enough, then we have received enough money, and then we have to be careful now with strategic investments. Okay. Now, you see that in the Mediterranean there is not so much. There are some investments in of course the port of Piraeus, the airport in Tirana in Albania. What is important is there the investments that China has made in Spain. In Spain they have bought the Noatum, the terminal operator who was controlling the port of Valencia as well as the port of Bilbao, as well as two large distribution terminals in Madrid and in Zaragoza, which means that they are becoming very, very strong. So they have the east in Piraeus, they have the west in Spain. And as of recent, with the visit of President Xi to Italy, it seems that they are developing also a strong interest for the ports of Trieste and Genova. And they have been discussing with two ports, nothing concrete, nothing in substance. They have agreed that they are going to put money into port investments in these two ports. No, Port of Venice says no. You were present.
I can tell you what they...
Okay, I have seen the memorandum, President.
Not, they took the word port away from the memorandum. They had to.
In the version that I have seen, which
Please,
was the version that was published in Italy, it says that we have agreed to invest in the ports of Genova and Trieste.
Well, go ahead.
Okay, if they change this, they may have changed this. Okay, a little in France, in Marseille, I would say, and then quite a lot in Northern Europe. In Spain, in Rotterdam, and so on. So we've mentioned about this, the way that China is looking to sort of spread their eggs and their interests all across the South European part of the Mediterranean. Well, we've said what happened last week in Rome. A lot of criticism recently is taking place as to the geopolitical intentions of China and the debt trap diplomacy that Chinese financing and investments might be involved. I would skip this transparency because I said in the beginning I don't want to go too much into conspiracy theories. And unless they can be proven, and for instance, in the case of the Habantota port in Sri Lanka, which has been used as a as a focal point of such a policy, in my view, it was more rather public sector corruption taking place there rather than any other intentions, because the loans they were rather concessionary, 2% interest rates. Investments of China in Sri Lanka, they are not as considerable, as large as there are Japanese investments in Sri Lanka. As a matter of fact, far, far more investments of Japan rather than China. And also in the port of Piraeus, which has been very, very focal. In Europe, we didn't like so much what happened in Piraeus and the attitude of China and Piraeus in this investment. There are certain things that happened that shouldn't have happened, let's put it this way, but then the port after the concession to COSCO has jumped to position 36 from 90 something. It's the second port after Valencia in the Mediterranean, sixth port in Europe. So it is a tremendous growth, a exponential growth. Not many Chinese they have come there to work. 3,000 Greeks they are being employed in port operations. Indirect impacts of the investments, another, I think, 10 times.
10,000.
And yes, and there is a sort of disillusion with Piraeus, because the COSCO presented a master plan for 600 million investments in that port, and the government said, oh, sorry, we're not ready to go ahead yet. This disillusion meant that COSCO started to look to Italy. This is how it started. They tried to play a little bit between the two countries. So I said, well, okay, you don't like our investments, then let's have a look and see what happens at the port of Trieste and at the port of Genova. So this also happened, but then I was informed only yesterday that it seems that the government and COSCO, they have agreed that the investments, the new master plan, should go ahead, should take place. Yeah, we pass this. The EU screening mechanism we discussed. Has China started to downplay BRI? Yes. China is not talking so much about BRI these days. They downplay it just because there has been so much discussion and hard feelings about the initiative. So in 10 days' time, on the 25th of April, there's the second BRI forum in Beijing. Everybody's going there, Putin and everybody else. Did you know that it was on the 25th? If you search and try to find out when is the date of the second BRI forum, you will not find it. I found it by accident, completely, through an email that was sent from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Moscow to some other people to inform them that Putin was going. So they don't talk about it very much. And investments, Chinese investments, they have been going down because the Chinese economy is cooling off. Since 2016, the Chinese economy has been cooling off considerably, and for 2019, we are expecting probably growth in China will be less than 6%. There is resistance, even by some Chinese people, because unemployment is going up. In 2018, 3 million industrial workers, they were laid off. So even within the Chinese citizenry, there is some reaction. Why do we need to invest in faraway places and we're not investing in our own country if we have this type of difficulties? So China has started to downplay a little bit, at least not be so enthusiastic as they used to be before. But BRI is letting off steam. This is indeed the case. And as I said, SAFE, which is the State Administration for Foreign Exchange, they have said now we also have to have a look at the investments of our companies, because you know it has to be relevant investments, that they are relevant to the core business of our companies, not in hotels and historic buildings and everything that is on sale. The North Sea routes. We've said a few things. I was never a believer in this idea, but I will skip this and we will wait tomorrow for Martin to see what he thinks. My ideas derive from the things that we have published before in the Journal of Maritime Economics and Logistics, where I haven't seen so far arguments very rather positive on the prospect of North Sea routes, other than the great interest that Russia has and China in partnership. Whatever happens in the North Sea routes, one thing is for clear: even if there is economic rent that is generated as a result of shorter distances and lower costs, this economic rent will be captured by Russia. You know that Russia has 5 controlling stations along the North Sea routes, and from everyone that you are passing, then you have to pay substantially there to come to Europe. So these also are things that we have to look into. BRI in South and Southeast Asia. Malaysia is the new kid in the block. This is something that doesn't make Singapore very happy. Until recently, China was advertising that they would like to create a second Singapore in Malacca. I don't know, with the return of the new Prime Minister Mahathir, he has cancelled lots of projects, and probably this one as well, because that was meant to be a $20 billion project that they wanted to do. So Singapore was not very, very happy with it. And of course, Singapore is not very happy with the fact that China wants to bypass the Straits of Malacca. And China wants to bypass the Straits of Malacca in two ways. One is with the Krak Canal in Thailand, which I will show you in a minute. And the other is with investments of China in Myanmar, particularly at the port of Kuak Pyu. And there again, China has big, big plans to build a tremendous 7 billion euro port there, with the intention to actually serve also the region, like, for instance, Bangladesh, and from Bangladesh, even the landlocked countries of Nepal and Bhutan. And they would like to do this, plus a huge distribution center, a 1,200 kilometers of railroads, 2 pipelines for gas and for oil, because they want to connect western part of China directly with energy inputs from the Gulf. All these are not making Singapore very, very happy, and Singapore has been complaining from the beginning as regards the BRI plans. China was saying, well, don't worry, but don't worry. The only thing that has happened since is that Costco has bought 2 more berths in your port, so they have now 5 berths instead of 3, and I don't know what are the plans of BRI with Singapore. Here we are then. I have discussed about Myanmar. The situation in this country is very, very tricky. Many people say that there's ethnic cleansing that is taking place, because then the Muslim population in this country is not welcome, and they are moving massively. They are moving to Bangladesh. The Krak Canal will connect. It's a very old idea. The canal cuts Thailand in two, in this way bypassing the Malacca Straits. It will employ a lot of people. It will cost $30 billion to be built. Recently, the government in Thailand said, well, we are not certain yet. This is not a high priority economic project for us. But if I can move a little bit, here it is. Yes, now we passed, we went to Nicaragua. I just wanted to show you something that I consider quite uh, interesting. So we can look here. Yeah. This is the one. Yeah. So if you see here, the crack canal is there. I cannot show you. Use this. Maybe this.
No. This is not connected.
Yeah.
To that.
Okay. But if you see. The crack canal is there, and then is coming in the middle of the Bay of Bengal, south of the Andaman and Nicobar islands, where India has placed their navy. So you see also the geopolitical aspects from Gwadar to Sri Lanka and to Kyaukpyu, you see this angle there. It looks like China is encircling India, and India does not like this very much. So they have put their navy out there, below the red line. So this map is interesting because you can also see the plans of China for the Pakistani port of Gwadar. Arch enemy of India. India does not like this type of cooperation, so they are bypassing Gwadar and they are looking into the north-south. Here you can see the north-south corridor, which starts from the Persian Gulf and it goes all the way up to Moscow. You see the black red line here in the Black Sea. That was a project I'm quite proud because I introduced this idea 3 or 4 years ago in Amsterdam, and I introduced the idea of connecting the Caspian with the Black Sea. And only recently, maybe you have read in the newspapers, 4 countries, they have signed a memorandum to create the corridor that starts from Turkmenistan, passes the Caspian Sea, goes to the port of Baku, connects to the port to the 2 ports of Georgia, probably the new port that the United States Conti is building there in Anaklia. And then my idea was that it crosses the Black Sea, it comes to Istanbul, it branches a little bit up to Romania, to the coast of Constanza, where the Chinese, they have also put money, and from the port of Constanza, because we have a corridor, a European Union corridor, which is the Danube, the Danube Rhine corridor, then I could see a connection from Central Asia all the way up to Rotterdam. So that was something that actually happened, and the MOU was signed by the ministers of foreign affairs of the 4 countries. Another project which I have found interesting, and I would like to show you before I move to the conclusions, because Angela is looking at me, was a project of connecting the Persian Gulf, which is very strategic. Everybody's looking at the Persian Gulf. China has investments in Oman and in Qatar. Everybody is investing there. Gwadar is playing a major role because this is the axis that connects the Gulf with the western part of China. The Iranians are developing aggressively their ports. Bandar Abbas and Chabahar on the Gulf. India is looking very, very strongly into these possibilities because India from here, from Bombay, is exporting a lot of stuff to Russia and to Europe. So they're quite keen to explore eventually the north-south corridor that Russia and Azerbaijan and Iran they have built. So my idea, which I still promote and I still talk a lot about people from various governments, international organization, financing organizations. Here you have 3 ports at this point, at the upper northern part of the Gulf, 3 ports that they belong to 3 different countries, which are Kuwait, Iraq and Iran. These countries, they have been in war in the past among themselves. I'm trying to sell the idea of peace, and I'm trying to sell the idea that money is what counts, not other things. The idea is to create the airport system and connect the upper Gulf ports again with the Mediterranean Sea. And this, the railway exists, it is in good condition, south of the Caucasus Mountains. It could come to Syria, sooner or later things will improve, and or to Lebanon, if you like. And from there, it connects again to the port of Piraeus, to the Italian ports of, I should say, Venice, Trieste, and Genova. And from there, all the way up to Northern Europe. And if you could connect this port system there with, you see, this, sorry that I cannot point, with the Tehran part of the North-South corridor, then you have a fantastic system. Then you have connected the two seas, you have connected the Persian Gulf, you have connected the North-South railroad connection, and then you have a system. You have a system not only of Central Asia, but a system that connects Central Asia to Europe. Finally, I didn't say much about Djibouti. Djibouti is a very interesting place, also controlled by China. Actually, very recently, China kicked out DP World, and China had to pay an awful lot of money for compensation, because DP World, they were running the terminal there. An interesting place because everybody has a naval base in Djibouti, the French, the Germans, the Italians, the Americans, etc. So this is, and the Gulf of Aden is the place where illegal arms trade is taking place. This is the place. A few words on Nicaragua, and then quickly on conclusions. Where is Nicaragua? No. Here we are. That's another important project. Important project for the countries in the region, and the countries in the region, Brazil, Venezuela, Panama, and the United States. The canal is quite lengthy. It's 275 kilometers. I would greatly appreciate the views of Rodolfo on the Nicaragua canal. Why? Because I foresee difficulties for Panama if ever the canal is being built. There was a period of cooling off in view of environmental pressure and reasons. I understand in here that things are picking up again. This is a big project. The project, what would be the purpose of the Nicaragua canal? The purpose of the Nicaragua canal would be to serve bulk exports and not containers. Nicaragua canal will have a depth of 25-26 meters, which means that it can accommodate the largest of ships that we know, but not container ships. Container ships that are coming from Asia cannot go to the east coast of North America of this size. 20-25, this type of ships, they cannot go there for reasons of bridges, of drafts, and everything. So Panama has optimized, and the 14,000 TEU ship that now they can go from Panama Canal is the ones that they can go also on the east coast of North America, no more than that. So it wouldn't serve container traffic plying eastwards to the east coast of America, no. So in this regard, Panama has no difficulty. But Nicaragua Canal, if ever, I repeat, is constructed, will serve Venezuelan oil, will serve Brazilian ore, would serve American grains by using the very, very, very large ships. So I could see this as a one-way impact rather towards westwards rather than for container shipping. Conclusions, very quickly. Yes.
Okay. Look, they look a lot, but they're not so much. The Chinese economy is slowing down. The rhetoric about the BRI is also slowing down. Chinese investments are being looked at more and more carefully, both by the Chinese and the money recipients. We have not seen any evidence so far that China is applying or is pursuing a debt trap diplomacy with countries in a neocolonial type of policy. The fundamental concept of the BRI is one of reducing trade and transport costs through better connectivity. So these days it seems everything is about connectivity. China considers the Mediterranean basin as a global super hub that could serve three continents. The major beneficiary of the Nicaragua Canal, where are we? Yes, would be westward, as I've just said, for bulk exports. The Iran-Azerbaijan-Russia North-South transport corridor is Russia's answer, in a way, if you like, with the system that I presented to you, is their answer to BRI. Unlikely, to my view, that a North Sea route over the Arctic could ever be a viable alternative to the modes that we have so far. With investments in Myanmar and Thailand, China bypasses the Strait of Malacca. Outside China, the focal points and ports of China are the ports of Piraeus, Djibouti, Gwadar, Habantota, Kiaokpiu, as well as the Chinese ports that I showed to you. Connecting the Persian Gulf to the Mediterranean basin is another project that I am projecting, I'm trying to sell. And the rest you're not interested in, because it was meant to be a little bit of self-promotion, which we can skip. And in a sense, then that's about it. Trying to summarize a subject that is not possible to summarize. I was speaking with the other day with someone from the Chinese Development and Reform Commission, and he said, Hercules, you know, the next room, how many papers and research outputs that I have collected. I said, you surprise me. And he says, I have 10,000 articles and papers on the issue that I've collected. And you know how many I have kept? I said, well, surprise me. He says, well, I have kept only 10. 10 or something like this, he said. So it's something that very, very difficult to summarize and visualize, actually, because what is there to visualize? Every investment that China is making and the recipient is taking, we call it BRI. So this is why I said in the beginning, at least we try to stick to the facts, and we try to stick to the ports, and we try to stick to maritime networks, and try to see how this could be, in a way, optimized. And we looked into West Africa, we looked into the Yangtze River, and we also looked into possibilities of industry relocation along the Silk Road, and trying to, you know, to stay away from other aspects like alternative investments, interests, or otherwise that China would like to pursue.
Okay.